Today I'm out of my indentures. Today I meet you forever.
Oh, this is quite unaccountable. A keener hand at sculpting a cunard or a cutting out a white star has never shipped a hand spike.
Yes, I have done my best for you. And why? It was my duty under my indentures. And I'm a slave of you. As a child, I was regularly apprenticed to your man. It was through an error. No matter. The mistake was ours, not yours. And I was not bound by it.
An error? What error?
I may not tell you. It would reflect upon my well-loved roof. Me, dear master! My mind has long been gnawed by the cankering tooth of mystery. But to have it all out at once.
And when you attack a stronger party, you invariably get thrashed.
There is some truth in
boy, is never molesting an orphan.
Of course! We are orphans ourselves and know what it is.
Yes! What is it about? And what is the consequence? Everyone we capture says he's an orphan. The last three ships we took proved to be manned entirely by orphans. One would think that Great Britain's entire mercantile navy was recruited solely from her orphans' asylum, which we know is not the case.
But hang it all, you wouldn't have us absolutely merciless.
Here's my difficulty. Until 12, I wouldn't. After 12, I would. Was ever a man placed in so delicate a situation?
And Ruth! Your Ruth, whom you love so well, was one of a middle-aged way into your boyish heart. What is to become of her?
Oh, he will take you with him.
Yeah! Well, Ruth, I feel some little difficulty about you. It is true that I admire you very much, but I have been at sea since I was 8 years old, and yours is the only woman's face I've seen. I think it is a sweet face. I say, I think it is. But as I have never had the opportunity of comparing you to other women, I may be mistaken.
True!
What a terrible thing it would be if I were to marry this innocent person and find out that she is on the whole plain.
Thank you.
21 usually looks for a wife of 17.
A wife of 17? You'll find me a wife of 1,000!
No, but I will find you a wife of 47, and that's quite enough.
Ruth, tell me candidly and without reserve. Compared with other women, how are you?
I will answer you truthfully, dear master. I have a slight cold, but otherwise, I'm quite well.
Well, I'm sorry for your cold, but I was referring more to your personal appearance. Compared with other women, are you beautiful?
I have been told so, dear master.
Ah, but lately?
No, years and years ago.
Well, what do you think of yourself?
It is a delicate question to answer, but I think I'm a fine woman.
That is your candid opinion?
Why, yes, I should be deceiving you if I told you otherwise.
Thank you, Ruth, for I'm sure you would not practice upon my inexperience. I wish to do the right thing, and if, I say if, you are truly a fine woman, your age shall be no obstacle to our union. Hark! Surely I hear voices. Who is dared to approach our all with the accessible lane? Is it the custom house? No, it does not sound like it.
You're beautiful! What is the young girl? This is even my law!
Come on! A very beautiful young maiden!
Law!
How lovely! How surpassingly lovely is the plainest of them! What grace! What delicacy! What refinement!
Ruth! Ruth told me she was here!
Oh, false one! You have deceived me!
Thank you.
Wait. And his happy set strictly to set foot anywhere!
will not be undetected.
But who are you to speak?
I am a pirate.
Oh, a pirate!
Ladies and gentlemen, this evening I renounce my vile profession, and to that end of cure and fearless maidens, oh, blushing buds of ever blooming.
Thank you. are to stay. False and Bobby exclaims, freedom from whatever. Play at other games, leave them here together. Her cake may any day be yours, my dear, or mine. Let her make her hay while the sun does shine. Let us compromise, our hearts are not of leather. Let us shut our eyes and talk about the weather.
Yes, yes, let's talk about the weather.
To be married with impunity, and indulge in double duty. their father is a major general.
Yes, yes, he is a major general.
Yes, he is a major general.
He is who brought the name
with her. What are you?
We're all single gentlemen.
Oh, yes, I gathered that. Anything else?
No, nothing else.
Come on, don't believe them. They are pirates. The famous pirates of Penzance.
Who was a pirate once, but who is now his adventure today? And we usually play with life
lore. Ah, but I object to pirates and songs in lore.
We object to major generals as fathers in lore.
We look over it.
Now, I have an idea.
And do you mean to say that you would deliberately rob me of these, the sole remaining props of my age, and leave me to go through the remainder of my life unfriended, unprotected, and alone?
That's the idea.
Oh, have you ever known what it is to be an orphan?
Often.
Pardon me, you didn't.
I only repeated it once.
I just dreamed what you repeated.
But not often.
Oh, stop. I believe I see we're getting confused. You say often, do you mean often a person who's lost his parents or often frequently?
No, only once.
Yes, yes. Often frequently, only once.
Telling a terrible story. leave my father some?
I will try, dear Mabel, but why does he sit here night after night in this drafty old ruin?
Why do I sit here? To escape from the pirate's clutches, I describe myself as an orphan. And heaven help me, I am no orphan. I came here to humble myself before the tears of my ancestors and to implore their pardon for having brought disgrace upon what I have no doubt was an unstained feminine escutcheon.
Be comforted. For had you not acted as you did, these reckless men would assuredly have called in the nearest clergyman and married your large family on the spot.
In this chapel are ancestors. You cannot deny that. With the estate, I bought the chapel and its contents. I don't know whose ancestors they were, but I do know whose ancestors they are. And I certainly think that they're descended by purchase, if I may so describe my... to deprive disgrace upon their family escutcheon.
But you forget, sir, he only bought this property a year ago, and the stucco on your baronial castle is scarcely dry.
I thank you for your proffered solace, but it is unavailing. I assure you, Frederick, that such is the anguish and remorse I feel at the abominable falsehood by which I escaped these easily deluded pirates, that it would go to their simple-minded chief this very night and confess all. Did I not fear that the consequences would be most disastrous to myself? At what time does your expedition march against these scoundrels?
At 11. And before midnight, I hope to have atoned my involuntary association with these pestilent scourges by sweeping them from the face of the earth. And then, dear Mabel, you will be mine.
Are your convicted followers at hand?
They are. They only await my orders.
Then, Frederick, let your escort lion-hearted be summoned to receive a general's blessing ere they depart upon their dread adventure.
Dear sir, they come.
Toronto,
lives up to great distress on the wrist at honest press for a reference a lack to our chance of coming back. Still, perhaps it would be wise not to clock or criticize, for it's very evident these intentions are well meant.
Yes, it's very evident these intentions are well meant. Evident, yes, well meant.
Measure for the repeated acts of theft and pillage, of which, at duty stern dictation, I, circumstances victim, have been guilty.
Young Frederick!
Who calls?
Your late commander!
How dare you face me? Know ye not, O rash ones, that I have doomed you to extermination?
On us. Hear us ere you slaughter.
I do not think I ought to listen to you. Yet, mercy should annoy our stern resentment. And so I will be merciful. Say on.
A paradox, a paradox.
surprise. Following to the agency of an ill-natured fairy.
You are the victim of this clumsy arrangement.
Having been born in leap year on the 29th of February. And so, by simple arithmetical process, you will easily discover that although you've lived 21 years, yet if we go by birthdays, you're only 5. And a little bit over.
Dear me, let's see. Yes, yes, with yours, my hand, yours, you. Halfway to the ways of paradox, said she gaily mocked. In the usual way, here's 21, I get a
that to save his contemptible life, he dared practice on our credulous simplicity? And I think I am right in saying that our revenge shall be swift and terrible. We shall go gather our band and attack to Morning Castle this very night.
Today.
Not a word. He is doomed.
Upon my soul of
party and in mind.
Toronto, 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 Toronto.
I'm timidly inclined.
Toronto, Toronto.
And anything but blind.
Toronto, 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 Toronto.
To the danger that's behind.
Toronto, Toronto.
Yet when the danger's near.
Toronto, 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 Toronto.
We manage to appear.
Toronto, Toronto.
As insensible to fear.
Sergeant, approach! Young Frederick was to have led you to death and glory.
That is not the pleasant way of putting it.
No matter, he will not so lead you, for he's allied himself once more with his old associates.
He has acted shamefully.
You speak falsely. You know nothing about it. He has acted nobly.
He has acted nobly.
Dearly as I loved him before, his heroic sacrifice to his sense of duty has endeared him to me tenfold. But if it was his duty to constitute himself my foe, it is likewise my duty to regard him in that light. He has done his duty. I will do mine. Go ye and do yours.
Righto.
This is perplexing.
We cannot understand it at all.
Still, he is actuated by a sense of duty.
That makes a difference, of course. At the same time, we repeat, we cannot understand it at all.
No matter, our course is clear. We must do our best to capture the pious alone. It is most distressing to us to be the agents whereby our erring fellow creatures are deprived of that liberty which is so dear to us all. But we should have thought of that before we joined the force. When a felon's not engaged in his employment,
his employment,
or maturing his felonious little plans,
little plans,
his capacity for innocent enjoyment,
sent enjoyment,
is just as great as any honest man.
Honest man's
are feeling difficulties, mother.
Difficulties, mother.
With this stabulary duties to be done.
To be done.
I take one consideration with another.
With another.
A policeman's life is not the happy one.
Oh, with
this
stabulary duties to be done. To be done. A policeman's life is not the happy one.
Cutthroat isn't occupied in crime.
Hiding crime.
He loved to hear the little brook a gurgling.
Brook a gurgling.
And listen to the merry village chime.
Village chimes.
When the cop is finished jumping on his mother.
On his mother.
He loves to lie a basking in the sun.
In the sun.
I take one consideration with another.
With another.
A policeman's lot is not the happy one.
We see the familiar
I thought I heard an
feel alive.
Don't say you're hoping for.